Hey folks, this is Abel James, and thanks so much for joining us on this very special On the Road edition episode of the Fat Burning Man Show, where we talk about real food and real results. How do store-bought fermented foods, like sauerkraut and yogurt, you might ask, match up against the kind you can make at home? Well, most of the yogurts and air quote fermented foods you find in the grocery store are unfortunately sorely lacking in the live nutrients department. But when you eat the real thing, a food that's been fermented the right way for the right amount of time, you can tell that it's alive. It's burbling with little bubbles floating up, you can see it fizzing and hissing, and when you eat it, you can feel that it's actually doing something for you. There's a magic as well as a host of health benefits to the ancient low-cost methods of fermenting our foods. And what is the difference between homemade and store-bought? Well, it gets a little bit into the weeds, so thankfully, today we're here with a specialist. Today we're here with the wonderful and talented Tammy Brill, our dear friend. Tammy is a noted scientist and educator in the field of gut health and fermented foods. After nearly 30 years of teaching as a microbiology instructor and university lab supervisor for biology and chemistry labs, Tammy shifted gears to become a health coach and master fermenter. Tammy is a graduate of the Institute for Integrative Nutrition and an entrepreneur who started Fermented Delights, bringing homemade fermented foods like sauerkraut, kimchi, kvass, and more to farmers markets all around Pennsylvania. Tammy invited my wife Allison and I to speak at Penn State University back around the launch of the Wild Diet book and when I was on that ABC TV show. We had an absolute blast and even got to attend one of Tammy's microbiology classes and try an assortment of fermented foods. I think you're really going to dig this one. Now, before we get to the interview with Tammy, do you have a question or a comment for me? You might not find me on social media, number one, because I don't necessarily spend a whole lot of time there these days. And number two, because some of our accounts have been in precarious positions, or you might not be able to find them at all at this point. So the best way to keep in touch with us is to go to fatburningman.com and sign up for our newsletter. I'll send you a quick start guide, as well as we have a whole bunch of delicious free recipes available. You don't have to sign up for anything. Just go to fatburningman.com. You can find over 500 episodes of this show with transcripts and much, much more. So I encourage you to check that out. And if you'd like to support our work and keep this free show coming your way, then please visit us over at wildsuperfoods.com. That's our family company. And if you're looking for a super high quality protein supplement, this is the one that we take every day. Delicious, hot or cold. It's called collagen cocoa. And you can also make delicious brownies out of it, puddings, and much, much more. Great around the holidays, great around the new year too, when you're trying to slim down. 21 grams of protein per scoop in here. And you can't necessarily tell from the video, or certainly not the audio. This is 1.8 pounds of very, very concentrated protein goodness. So it's a big jumbo size container. And if you'd like to save even more, then please use the code WILD15 to get 15% off your first order. That's WILD and the number 15. Use that in the promo code box. Go and if you'd like to try Future Greens, Collagen Cocoa, Mega Omegas, Vitamin D Stack, Adrenal Stack, Probiotic Spheres, or anything else, throw that into the promo code if you want to save 15% at Wild Superfoods. That's the way to do it. And don't forget, if you'd like to save even more, you can sign up for Subscribe and Save over at wildsuperfoods.com for either single products or some of the bundles that we have over there. So get your nutrition on over at wildsuperfoods.com. All of you based in the U.S. anyways, we really appreciate your support there. All right, on to the show with Tammy Brill. We're chatting about what happened when Tammy had her microbiology class look at homemade yogurt and cafeteria yogurt under the microscope and what the differences were. Tips about longevity for your pets coming from someone who has a 23-year-old cat and two 13-year-old dogs. A healthy food swap when you're stressed and want something crunchy. Beginner-friendly fermented foods. The gut-brain connection and much more. Let's go hang out with Tammy. Welcome back, folks. Today we're here with the wonderful and talented Tammy Brill. Tammy is a noted scientist and educator in the field of gut health and fermented foods. After nearly 30 years of teaching as a microbiology instructor and university lab supervisor for biology and chemistry labs, Tammy shifted gears to become a health coach and master fermenter. She's a graduate of the Institute for Integrative Nutrition and an entrepreneur who started Fermented Delights, bringing homemade fermented foods like sauerkraut, kimchi, kvass, and more to farmers markets around Pennsylvania. Thank you so much for being here, Tammy. I feel like it's a long time coming.
Absolutely. Thank you. I'm honored to be on your podcast.
Righteous. Well, it's been a few years since we had a giant party and hung out in person. We had so much fun together tasting all sorts of things that you fermented in and out of your lab at home and talking about real food. And man, I really miss those times. Those are some of the best times of our lives, really. And the community that we all felt was just incredible. I'm sure there are a lot of people listening who have met both of us in person, but it's great to reconnect.
Yes.
So let's start with a question that always, I get multiple answers, but I figure you're probably a better person to ask than anyone. Is it kefir or kefir? Or does it matter? Is it both?
It doesn't matter. We're talking about the kefir, like the kefir that I sent you? I say kefir. Yes. You know that I wanted to send that to you because I was impressed with Dr. Davis's podcast and with the yogurt. And I thought, man, you know, you have to get a yogurt maker. You have to use half and half. And I thought, I got to send you. I mean, that's all great. I love all the scientific information about the Lactobacillus reuterii and the health benefits. But it just seems so complicated to make when you just throw some cultures in a jar, get some raw milk, and in a couple of days, you can let it go and it could get nice and fermented and sour. And you could use it instead of buttermilk for pancakes and waffles and bread making and even in your eggs.
That's amazing. And my dad tells this story about that's how his dad, my grandfather, on the farm way back in the day would make yogurt. He would milk the cow, or the cow would be milked, and then they'd put it out for a few days. And because of all the good stuff that was around, because of the healthy animals, especially back then, the lack of all these chemicals and what have you, for the most part, good stuff grew. And a few days later, you know, it also came out of the cow at room temperature. Well, at kind of cow temperature, right? And then it only went down to room temperature over time. And so it was getting that fermentation. And that's what a lot of people are missing. So how long did you let this one go? Because Dr. Davis, usually it's 36 hours for dairy, I think, right?
So I just basically, it ferments all year round. So I invested by Donna Schwenk, and there was a company called Kefirco. I forget what was the Jumpstart or Kickstarter, and they were selling the jars. But you know, you don't really need all those jars. You can just get a plastic spoon, and you could get a mason jar with plastic. And I had some friends interested in doing this and gave me grains. So you take the grains and then you pass them on because they multiply, especially in the summertime. So we're fortunate here to have lots of farmers that have licenses for the raw milk. So I can get it every week when I want to. And I use a nice variety of from all the cows, the heritage, the A2s, the Jersey cows. And you just take the grains. Well, you can buy culture grains too, powdered ones, and then they work for seven ferments. I just take it, put it in a mason jar and let it sit for one day, 2 days. It all depends on temperature and how you like it. I like it a little sour and creamier, and I give it to my animals too. It calms them down. In fact, that's what I gave them now, in addition to the melatonin. They're out like a light because the superstar bacteria in the kefir is called bifida. Along with all the wild grain, the bacteria that are in there as well, and lactobacilli. And why I started drinking the milk kefir, and that's what I was, I would challenge my college students in the labs. I never liked to do the cookbook labs, just give them a microorganism to look at underneath the microscope that had no meaning. They had a pull. I wanted to give them the raw milk kefir and then the yogurt that they were getting from the cafeteria that had sugar in it and hardly any probiotics. So then they would grow these in the microbiology lab. You could grow anything if you give it the right media, and they would grow them, look at these organisms underneath the microscope, and also do quantity tests to see what organisms are actually in there. So you got the lactobacilli, the bifidobacteria, and in that yogurt that was all sugar laden that you get in the grocery store, it's all full of sugar and chemicals. And there's no hardly any bacteria in there. And it's made with crappy milk, not this good fresh stuff. So this, we're lucky enough to get raw cream as well here, and raw butter. So I'm just in my glory. In Pennsylvania, there's no shortage of raw milk, raw butter, and raw dairy products.
It is. And in some states, it's really difficult.
Mm-hmm. I know that. And it was a challenge for me to keep going because, you know, when I worked in the college and I would, you know, the students would like to taste it. And people, there were colleagues of mine saying, you're going to get everybody sick with raw milk. And you know, that whole concept, people working in the hospitals with food poisoning. Preservation and fermentation are one of the ancient methods of food preservation. You're not going to get sick. That's the way it was meant to be, because they kill all the pathogenic bacteria. And as I said, with my animals, I gave it to them to sleep now. It's very good with the bifido, which a lot of us don't have them. When I did my eubiome test back in 2016 and 2017, I think they're out of business now, but I had no bifidos. You know, and you need bifido for calming and the hormone production, and it's a very important constituent of your gut bacteria. And that's what they have in probiotic formulas, is bifido. Well, I don't need to take the probiotics because I drink my raw milk kefir.
So what in particular did your students see in the if we could go a little deeper into, maybe we'll start with the cafeteria yogurt, or just the standard, you know, yogurt that you would buy at the store. Did you look at it with or without sugar and see any differences there?
Well, I would use mine as the control with no sugar in it. And it was all the full teeming with organisms. So you could look at the types of organisms growing on the media. So mine would be chock full, and then you would count the colonies, and then we do these tests to identify them. When they did their culture from the cafeteria that was filled with sugar and chemicals, there wasn't anything growing on them. So they pretty much knew that they were eating crap and chemicals. Did it make a difference? I think their brains were pretty much hijacked with the sugar and the chemicals. You know, wanted to eat it. And of course, you're a poor college student, so you're going to eat what the cafeteria gives you until you learn about making more, you know, making it from scratch, which is easy.
Yeah, it definitely can be. And contamination can happen. I know it's happened to us making kombucha, making sometimes dairy, and like there's visible mold, or one time the flies got in there for the kombucha and it was gnarly. But it's pretty obvious, especially if you have a decent sense of smell and you're willing to look and smell and kind of do those kind of old fashioned tests, because this is, like you said, this is the ancient way, and there were several others, but fermentation is hard to beat in terms of making fermented beverages drinkable, storing vegetables and dairy for longer periods of time. Maybe you can talk about the other kind of magical ancient low-cost benefits of fermentation for a minute.
Well, one of the things right now, I'm in a little bit of a slump. My beet kvass is my beet guy. My beet kvass is very popular. And I believe when in 2016, that's what I was starting out with. And you sampled some of it. And I started working on, you know, a formula. But the beets are in their prime from June until October. Right now, I only use organic beets because you need the skins on. You need, and I always have a special request. All the farmers in the area know that I need my beets from my farmer's market to make my beet kvass. So you need the skins on because you get all the soil microorganisms that take all the nutrients from those beets. So in the summertime, when I ferment them and then I add organic turmeric and ginger, they go through a fermentation process. So when the beets are nice and purple, in the summertime, my beet kvass is awesome and it's nice and purple. But now in the wintertime, it's a challenge. Even though my beets are organic, it's not the greatest of the beet kvass. And you could taste the difference because they're older. They're not at their best because as they get older, like you said, with contamination, the yeast take over. I had one well-meaning farmer, the boys got a nice big thing of organic beets and they washed them. And I'm not sure if it was with chlorinated water. And I didn't know this until after I started fermenting my beets. And yeah, I had the white mold on top and all the yeast, and you can't use it. That's why you have to keep that nice, happy balance. That's what's the beauty of my fermentation business is, because I'm a microbiologist. So I've done all the hacks. And a lot of people say, well, I tried to make this, I tried to make that. It's not as good as yours. But you have to learn that nice balance of the organisms when you're making your ferments, as well as it works the same way with the organisms in your gut. You have to keep that happy balance to be healthy. So it's, you know, that's where I'm at with explaining to people about fermentation and health.
And you make so many different kinds of foods. You said you're so wonderful to send all of these jars to us. We've tried, I think, all of them at this point, and they're fantastic.
The carrots and the belly kraut, my girls, not my cat, but my
it's hissing at me. It's alive. Yeah.
You can drink that. That is nice and fizzy with the ginger. That's the carrots. You can give the carrots to the dogs. My dogs eat the ginger carrot rounds because it takes the sugar out. And then you do gut shots with the liquid because of ginger gut shots. And it's a good way. I got laughed at with the ginger carrot rounds when I first started making them. I called them my healthy potato chips. So my whole business was healthy food swaps. Boy, it was a challenge to try to get people, you know, for the potato chip, because you want that crunch when you're stressed. But the healthy swap is the carrots. And then people started catching on with putting them on, just adding them on salads and that. The belly kraut, I think I sent you the belly kraut. My dogs love that. I think I have a video of my Hannah on my YouTube channel eating and you can hear the crunch. And
oh,
it's so healthy for them. And there's a reason why I also make my ferments and give them to the animals, because of my with the environmental challenges and reading the power of ferments, not only populating our gut with the beautiful bacteria, but they also help get rid of toxins, which we can talk about. I'd like to let people know the power of ferments, whether it's, you know, my fermented delights, or I encourage people after this podcast, hopefully people will go seek out people in their respective states until I start. If I ever find that partner that, you know, shares my vision and passion and, you know, has a good web, web capabilities, and we could get something going to ship it and my own place. For now, I just say, you know, find some fermented foods, somebody in your place, in where you live, because that's going to keep you healthy. And I believe that the fermented foods kept me healthy the past 2 years, and they saved my life. And I've only built more, you know, on my passion. I built more. I'm up to about 30 varieties of kraut. Yeah.
Oh my gosh.
Adjusting that from 20, now it's up to 30, and then people give me ideas.
That's incredible. So are you using the same starter for all of these? Do you have different strains of starters, or are you starting from scratch each time? How does that work?
Okay, so what I do is where you're getting the whole idea of eating fermented foods and the variety that I make is for microbial diversity. So I am lucky enough in this area that we have a lot of farmers that practice sustainability and regenerative agriculture. In fact, about a month ago, I gave a presentation to the Women in Ag conference where I learned about switchgrass and the regenerative farming, and they're trying to get farmers and educate farmers more into not using chemicals, which are basically killing us and our animals and wildlife. And I learned a lot about the honeybees.
And the soil.
The soil is basically dead. You know, you got soil and you got dirt and rocks and nothing in there. So I use the same, like a couple different starter cultures, you know, Donna Gates and Donna Schrank, why I use the starter culture instead of something like whey from the kefir or something else, or just let it wild ferment, is, you know, I'm regulated by the Department of Ag. So the starter culture keeps the pH at a nice level so that the any pathogenic organisms don't take over. So it keeps it at a nice perfect pH. So at the end of every batch, I make in small batches, it keeps it at a perfect pH for my ferments. But the variety of microbial diversity comes from all the different farmers and all their different types of soil and all their vegetables.
Right.
That's
right.
Where the variety comes in. And then I'm also shopping local for organic carrots because I don't, you know, you got the nutrient. You don't want to be peeling all those carrots for everything. You want, with the skins on, you want the soil microorganisms on there. So I tell everybody, don't wash anything because I have to, that keeps the integrity. And you don't want that yeast to overgrow. As soon as people start touching, washing, you get that imbalance, and then you don't have that proper fermentation process. So usually when I order, I pick up that day, then I go to my kitchen, and then I'm fermenting everything. And then take it from there.
And a lot of people really haven't tried. Yeah, I think it does. But some people listening, maybe they haven't tried the style of food that you make, especially vegetables. Because if you go into the deli section and you get sauerkraut, it's dead for the most part. It's kind of, it looks like it might be sauerkraut, but in a lot of cases, it's not the same thing as what we're talking about here. When you make these ferments that are alive and that they're, you know, fizzy and hissing at you if you don't completely close the jar. For me, and Allison and I've talked about this as well, you kind of get a head high when you have it, especially if you need it. So maybe you can talk about the gut-brain connection a little bit and how this is different from the sauerkraut that maybe some people might be familiar with.
Yeah, well, where do we want to start here? It's a transition process. So we, you know, listening to your other podcasts about the healthy lifestyle, the unhealthy lifestyle we're living in, the standard American diet, and especially what has been happening the past 2 years. What did everybody do when we were locked down? And I hope we don't get censored, but everybody went right to the middle aisles of the grocery stores. They grabbed all the, you know, all the junk and all the processed fruit. And then they sat in front of the TV and their brains basically became hijacked with all of these chemicals and the sugar. And it basically was worse than drugs. Oh, and then everybody was drinking too. I mean, alcohol sales just went skyrocketed. So what happened is reading Dr. Perlmutter's book, he made a tremendous influence on my life, learning about the brain and all of that. And I read all of his books and he calls it disconnection syndrome. So we have if we had a healthy body like our ancestors did, and we lived that lifestyle, which of course that's not the way it is in the world today. We have to try to live our ancestral eating lifestyle in an evolving world today to keep our bodies healthy. There's a communication system with the vagus nerve. When we eat the wrong food, that communication system just gets so messed up. in so many ways. I don't know how you want me to go off onto a tangent, because I could explain a little bit more about that and then how fermented foods would come in to help regulate the gut health. So basically, when we eat healthy food, there's a proper communication between the gut and the brain, because everybody's happy, the microorganisms are happy. We're supposed to have a happy balance of the good bacteria in our gut. And when we eat real food, it's going to get digested, it's going to get absorbed, it's going to take all of those proper, the key word is metabolites, and it's going to go through all the parts of our body to be happy and help us grow in the way that we were meant to be. But with us eating all the bad and processed food, these metabolites, so there, it's a cascade reaction, like over 50 metabolic reactions occur in our gut with all of these bacteria. When they get messed up, you have a biochemical reaction, and then that end product is supposed to get used by another bacteria, and then it goes on and the cycle continues. When you don't have that proper metabolite, it just messes up the rest of the cascade effect, and then you have that disconnection syndrome. So people, what's happening when you make the poor food choices, you're getting, your increase in blood sugar, you're getting increased weight, inflammation, cortisol, and you're thinking with your amygdala, it's getting hijacked. And we're supposed to be thinking with our prefrontal cortex. And I don't think that has been happening in the past 2 years with everybody just, and basically our brains are being hijacked and the food has become biological weapons. So where does fermented foods come into play? Did you ever, are you aware of Stephanie Seneff from MIT? She wrote the book Toxic Legacy. Mm-hmm. And she started researching about children and autism. And she has her thoughts about the pandemic as well and what's going on. But what's happening when fermented foods will come and get rid of these toxins and help the liver detoxify them. And you're getting all the good bacteria that are going to get those bad bugs out of you and their detrimental effects. And then you can when you eat that, when people eat the bad food and then they get introduced to the fermented foods, it's sometimes a yuck factor. Because so many people have candida overgrowth and their body, that communication, that candida is saying, I want more sugar, I want more sugar. And then you have the healthy lactobacilli, you have that, the lactic acid, that sour taste, the ginger taste, the gut shots. People don't like that. And their brain, it's like, ooh, what's going on here? And then they get frustrated. But that's why you have to introduce a little bit at a time with each meal. So when I make my fermented foods, I try to make a nice variety that one person would say, oh, I like this one. I started off with my apple krauts because people still have that sugar craving. So one of the places where I hooked up with a nutrition center, when the health coach comes in and does these challenges with her groups, she says some of them don't even know what kale is like. They never ate kale before. So we started with the apple krauts, which have been a big hit. And I just made a batch of jalapeno apple kraut, which people like.
Oh, so man, that sounds so good.
They have a sweet flavor, and the people starting there can eat a little bit, and then slowly, along with her health recommendations, then they go into more of a variety of helping change their taste buds and their palate.
And your habits, just the pattern of having a craving and then indulging in a sweet food or one that isn't alive, that isn't a probiotic, that doesn't have bitter or sour or those types of tastes. Yeah, it's a little grim to think about, but a lot of people's cravings aren't really coming from them. They're coming from yeast, or they're coming from some sort of parasitic you know, being that's overwhelmed their body and has hijacked their cravings, in fact, for them. So that when you do have those good foods, there's that yuck factor, but that's also not coming from you. And so building those grooves in those habits does take a bit of time and probably some, you know, beginner friendly foods. And some of your krauts and other ferments seem pretty mild, and other ones are more hardcore. And I love that you have that variety, because people are on, you know, the beginner level, and then there's like the expert level in terms of, you know, what you're willing to do to your taste buds, right?
And also, in addition to the apple krauts, you know, starting at the farmer's markets and trying to get my ferments, I had to make my my candy, my healthy candy, the sprouted bark and my bliss balls.
So good.
I think I sent you a sample of the bark.
Yeah, the chocolate bark with pumpkin seeds and all sorts of other things in there. It's delicious.
Yeah, so I would be bribing people to come to eat the chocolate, and I would make, instead of the soda, people are so addicted to soda, and that just robs your body of calcium and the phosphoric acid, the high in fructose, and causes the uric acid buildup. So to get people off of the soda, I make water kefir, which is less sugar than kombucha, and I make it with the citrus. So I would make a healthy probiotic lemonade, and boy, does that take off. But I tell people, you can't drink the whole jar, you know, because there's still sugar is still sugar. There's less sugar in it, but it's a healthier, you've got the whole organic lemon, you've got the probiotic effects that are going through there. So some people just don't do anything but the water kefir. But that's okay. They're at least, you know, they're drinking that instead of soda or alcohol with a meal. Like the beet kvass, you could drink, you know, in a wine glass. Somebody said to get himself off the soda habit, the wine habit, he was drinking the beet kvass in a wine glass. So that sugar in it. The beets, you know, beets and carrots are high in sugar. So you're turning those sugars and the starches from the bacteria into a healthy lactic acid, which is going to help kill that candida that's in there. And slowly you'll lose those sugar cravings. And then there is an instant high. You do feel better because they're mood boosters. You're getting that serotonin kick, because a lot of people, we don't have that buildup of lactobacilli. That's why I use my cultures to help rev up that process and keep them. I'd rather eat my sauerkraut and eat my probiotics than take a pill. And one teaspoon is more powerful than a whole pill of probiotics that you don't know if they're living or not.
Right. Absolutely. And there are a lot of things sold as probiotics these days that are nothing close to the fermented foods that we've been eating for centuries, you know, thousands of years, and really relying upon. And I'll say, where we live in Colorado now and have for a few years, it's very remote. There's a tiny little, you know, health food store, and then you've got to go pretty much an hour to the supermarket or whatever. And so we've really learned to appreciate getting our vegetable fill from kind of a small concentrated amount of fermented or pickled foods that we just keep in the fridge, you know, and that's kind of our source of vegetables in a lot of cases, is that small amount, because there is benefit in some cases having a giant salad, but it's just not that realistic for a lot of people in real life, especially these days. And so having just a little jar of fermented foods, just a few tablespoons, a few forkfuls, putting it on your meats or by your meats. We try to eat our meats with fermented foods. It can really add so much to the meal, and so much in terms of taste and flavor, and help you digest, a high meat diet or a high fat diet in a lot of cases as well.
Absolutely. At Forks Farm Market, someday the family band will come and play. But we give samples out there. They do their chicken and their beef, and they do hot dogs, and they grill everything up on the grill. And then we'll to put little samples of my sauerkrauts. And one of the hot sauerkrauts for the summer, I do a jalapeno purple picnic supreme. So when you eat that with the meat, it helps with digestion. You know, my goal someday, I gave you the purple picnic supreme with the garlic and the cumin and the caraway, but I have a summertime one. And I always tell people, buy a jar and give the gift of health for the summer picnics. That's what people need to do. And that's fermented foods, and you'll make people healthier one spoonful at a time. And Paul Saladino, the carnivore dude.
Yeah, he's been on the show. The carnivore
doc. I would love to challenge him to eat some fermented foods. Okay, if you need to reset your gut microbiome with just meat, I don't think people can live on meat alone. I don't know how he does it, but you need microbial diversity. I would love to see what his gut microbiome diversity. And I listened to his podcast with Dr. Mercola. He was in Tanzania. At least he was eating some tubers. But, you know, the green leafy vegetables, you know, I'm out there now. The honeybees are on the dandelion flowers, and I'm eating the mustard leaves and the dandelion leaves now. How can you not eat, you know, what Mother Nature is giving you? There's purslane around my yard, too. So I'm fortunate that I can keep my little area that it's not contaminated with pesticides. I don't like to cut my grass either because everything goes wild because I'm in a rural area. So I'm fortunate that I have a nice compost pile and then I plant my sunflowers and my greens and eat wild. The violets are coming up too, so you can eat them as well.
Love this time of year.
And it's all about the gut microdiversity, because the more microorganisms you have in your gut, that's the whole goal. You don't want to be limited. And I've been there, done that with every kind of diet. If you have more microbial diversity by eating real food and a variety of real food and lots of fermented foods, you're going to have you're going to have that metabolic flexibility from the microbial diversity. And unhealthy people don't have that flexibility, and we have the illness, and that it's a vicious cycle.
Yeah. One more thing about that vicious cycle, and another thing that can help if you don't have Tammy's wonderful ferments around you, having a bit of apple cider vinegar with the mother in it. Just usually I'll do a shot in basically 8 or 10 or 12 ounces of water and put some cinnamon in there, sometimes some hot peppers and ginger and all sorts of things like that. And when you get my wife Allison loves doing this too, but when you get a sugar craving or you kind of get a craving that doesn't seem to go away, a lot of times that will just kind of interrupt that pattern right there. Same thing that, you know, the pickled and fermented vinegar taste often does. So that's a really cool trick to be able to use. But a lot of people, you know, who are addicted to that cycle really, and that hit of sugar or carbs, the potato chips are hard to beat. There is a little bit of a shift if you're going to be having fermented carrots instead, right? But once you do, and once you do it a few times, you're just like, man, I feel so much better doing it this way.
It's the, you know, in the apple cider vinegar, I do that as well. It's the acetobacter, you know, you need to regulate that insulin. And we really shouldn't, if we eat real food the way that it was meant to be and don't overindulge in all the snacks, even the healthy organic snacks are not good. I've been researching about the omega-6 and the omega-3 balance. And that plays a big factor into people getting sick with inflammation in their body. That's why fermented foods, when you eat fermented foods, it lowers, we have I think conventional doctors test for 19 inflammation markers. When you eat fermented foods, it has been shown that those inflammation markers go down.
Wow.
And it keeps it, you know, it keeps that in check. I don't do all of the gadgets like everybody else does with all of these biohacks. I feel like I eat real food. I eat once a day, mid-morning, and I love my coffee in the morning, and then I do my hiking in the morning, and then I eat one solid meal a day. I'm more of a fish eater. I'm very fortunate as well. In my area, within a nice radius, I sell my ferments at a family business that it's called Wild for Salmon. My ferments fly off the shelves there. And I believe that people in the area, in fact, I was thinking when I was preparing for talking to you, I was thinking, wouldn't it be cool if I could get my followers, all the people who have eaten the ferments in the past 2 years and eaten healthy, like the wild salmon, how many people got sick? If they got sick, how were the symptoms? Did they have long hauler COVID? The omega-3 people that ate the fish and kimchi. I don't know if you saw my local TV debut when I did the kimchi lettuce wraps with the local salmon. You know, healthy, you could get very creative with fermented foods. So that's where I have a nice little niche there. I strategically sell at 10 places locally where there's all healthy healthy foods that people could eat. So that was my little secret as a health coach. People in my demographic, you know, people are interested, they know, but they're afraid. And so many people still want to listen to conventional doctors. They're not there yet. So I figured this was my way of making people feel healthier. And people didn't know what they were eating or drinking, but at the farmers markets, I was consistently there. I'll be in my fifth year now, but people started feeling better. At my mountaintop market, I have a now 85-year-old gentleman who his blood work and everything is spot on because he's been eating. He told the doctor he's eating my kimchi every single day, and he lives with his sisters. And he stinks them out with all with the garlic. Healthy, and he doesn't care. and the doctor.
Great.
That he had, you know, he's doing great, and he started losing weight. And he started, my customers give me little, I love learning from them, learning about Dr. Gundry, you know, and the longevity.
Yeah. Dr. Gundry, sure.
And the energy paradox, yes. So I learned a lot too. I mean, you know, everybody has all their own diets, but we're all different. In your one podcast, Jessica, I think, was talking about we're all bio-individuality, but we have a common theme. If we eat real food, we stay away from processed, you know, what hijacks the amygdala and stops us from, you know, rational thinking. And we go back to, you know, the way of eating that it was meant to be, we wouldn't have so many health problems and problems in the world in general, like violence and angry, hangry people because of this disconnection syndrome.
And I wonder as well what the relationship is, and there probably is some research about it, between people who have a healthy gut microbiome, eat fermented foods on a regular basis, and are able to do the one meal a day type approach and feel really great doing it. Because if you don't have that machinery already, then you're probably going to be hangry every 2 to 3 hours. You have to build that up over time, right?
Yeah, you have to be patient. And that's what happened to me. Some different factors played into my health and healing journey since we met. You know, if you're also eating against your genetics, that plays a big factor in your health. And a lot of people, they don't know this. They want to listen to the doctors, but the doctor said this, the doctor said that, and nobody talks to them about nutrition. And, you know, even though I was in 2016, I was starting to eat healthier food options, I wasn't eating according to my genetics, I still wasn't at my optimal. The fermented foods, as I started dabbling, kept me at bay, and I always kept my exercise up. But I believe that people wouldn't realize that at some point in my life, I think I told you this when we met, I had a heart attack at some point in my life and didn't even know it, thinking it was nauseous, you know, the typical symptoms, the dizziness, you know, just indigestion, didn't really know what was going on. But I've been doing detective work as I'm learning more about fermented foods, the gut microbiome, and the foods that we eat. If we eat against our genetics, then we have a lot of health problems. What happened to me, my father died in 2014 of non-Hodgkin's lymphoma at 74 years old, I believe. And that's way too young. And my mother, we grew up with her with a whole multitude of health issues. And, you know, the word celiac disease kept popping around in my family. And she had thyroid issues and health issues. And I never put two and two together about family, that this could all be genetically linked. And then as I was educating myself for the past 2 years, while we were in lockdown, Dr. Peter Osborne, I took his 14-hour glutenology masterclass, and I thought it just dawned on me, like, man, everything of my growing up and my health issues, even though I was still at bay with the fermented food, something still wasn't right. I caved in and did the genetic test. Never did I realize that I was eating against my genetics. I have 3 out of the 4 alleles, and for the gluten sensitivity, non-celiac, from both sides of my family. So my mom's got the neurological and the celiac, and my father had the neurological, which can lead to the non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. Well, this just happened maybe like 8 months ago. Then we met Iverly Well, and you were talking about food sensitivity test. Well, I thought, let me see what's going on, because my gut still wasn't good. You know, the fermented foods were doing good. They were helping me, but I still wasn't at my optimal. And, you know, hormonal wise, just still was a little off and couldn't figure it out. So I went, I did that, and I did a 30-day food cleanse. I had leaky gut. It was a no-brainer. I couldn't eat egg whites. I couldn't do my multi-collagen. I had minimal food sensitivities, but the highest one was the egg whites, the chicken egg whites. So I cut everything out. Sunflowers. I'm 6 months. In 6 months in June, I'll do another food sensitivity test, and I'll see if my gut is healed as I incorporate, you know, even more fermented foods and more variety into my gut. So going back to the one meal a day, one of the things when I did my ubiome test, I was always on this, you hear about this acromantia, and they're the keystone gut species. So we talk about intermittent fasting. I don't know if anybody on your podcast has mentioned this, but when you do your intermittent fasting, this keystone species, I had none of these keystone species in me. So when you intermittent fast, they live in the mucus layer of the gut lining. So you're giving your body a chance to rest, and the microorganisms can do what they can do without constantly feeding. So, so many people that have the diabetes and everything, you're just overloading your body. And then tracking, I use my Aura ring, and my heart rate variability is what works for me with knowing the foods that I ate and all of that. I haven't done the glucose monitor. I love my dates and I love my figs, but I kind of just, you know, a little bit here or there. But, you know, that the whole fructose is a little scary with the uric acid. But I believe you could eat if you're eating real food and not eating all of the processed, you know, crap in the grocery stores, you can get away with some dried fruit once in a while and eat your fruit. Now, there, you know, you listen to so many health advocates, they all have, somebody says don't eat blueberries, somebody says eat blueberries. If you eat real food and you have a healthy, you know, you should be able to, like the Weston Price Foundation, eat real food the way that it was meant to be. So I, you know, I had the gluten 30 years. Here's the thing that I learned from Dr. Osborne. He is so intelligent and he pretty much saved my life. And it's easy now for me to say, no, thank you. I had, you know, not only the gluten, but it was the wheat protein as well that caused me to eat it. So people say, oh, I don't have a gluten allergy. I don't have a wheat allergy, but they don't, you may not necessarily feel it in your gut. I have the double whammy for the neurological issues. So it makes sense why I have a lot of neurological damage, and my vagus nerve and some of my, my reaction and responses, because, you know, those pathways have been messed up and my gut has been ripped and ripped apart like a cheesecloth until you lose that loss of you have that loss of tolerance and your gut just leaks out all the what it can't digest into the bloodstream called LPS, which is basically bacteria poop causing that inflammation in the body. So when you're not eating and eating once a day, then you give that body a chance and the acromantia can reestablish itself and then the body can get rid of all that gunk. Now, another thing about the acromantia is at the time in 2016, they never had a probiotic for acromantia. They couldn't find a way to grow it. I don't know if you know it. I forget the name of the company, but now they have a probiotic for acromantia. So here's what's interesting. Our brains are all hijacked with our amygdalas through commercialism. And I always like to watch commercials because I think it's psychological BS. And yeah. I like to, you know, you see all of these prescription pills, but then they give the list of all the side effects. Humira is one of them. And then they have all the famous people. Oh, my Humira, my rheumatoid arthritis. Well, I'll tell you what, I have the neurological, the rheumatoid arthritis. And these pills, these doctors are pseudo compassionate. They're not getting to the root cause of the inflammation. It's only going to mask the symptoms and give toxins into your body. So acromantia, okay, so you can take the probiotic, but you could do intermittent fasting. And acromantia loves pomegranate and dragon fruit. Now, of course, there's going to be those, you know, Dr. Mall says, oh, don't be eating the sugary fruits and everything. I don't see a problem with eating. If you eat real food and you don't eat crap food, your body can handle the fruit with the fructose in it and the fiber. Agreed. And feed the gut bacteria and wouldn't eat it that way. So I don't worry about macronutrients and that I'm getting a nutrient density and variety in my one meal. And I spread that out during, you know, a 4-hour period before I go and do my work. If I eat past 3 o'clock, I check my aura ring in the morning and I have a crappy sleep. I don't get the deep sleep. My heart rate variability tanks. And, you know, trying to keep it up in the 50s and the 60s. Even if I have a glass of wine, it tanks down to the 30s. Can't do it.
Wow.
So the aura ring does track. I mean, you know, I could do the glucose monitor, but I don't go to doctors. I can say that I healed myself on my own. I wouldn't tell everybody to go and do that. You know, I'm an experiment of one, like so many people that you have interviewed on the podcast. We're all doing our own experiment. And that's what's great, because we're spreading the word of health. And, you know, maybe somebody might pick something up from this podcast and say, hey, you know, I might try this. You know, maybe it'll work for you. The one big thing, if you can't do the intermittent fasting, is at least don't eat 3 hours before you go to bed.
Yeah.
You know, and that'll give your body a chance to rest.
We've got just a couple of minutes left. I want to make sure that you talk about some of your experiments at home that are really going well, or at least according to longevity. Pets are often reflective of the health of the owner of that pet or the caretaker of that pet, right? And so you in particular, and I didn't realize this before today, have a couple of dogs that are 13 years old, right? And then a cat that's 23. Is that right?
Yes.
Tell us about that.
Yeah, they, well, you know, we should not, kibble is made for our convenience. And it's one of the worst things that we could be feeding our animals. And they're made with all the scraps, even the canned cat food. That's like kitty cocaine and doggy cocaine. And it's not healthy. It makes their livers and detoxing a little bit more difficult. So we're fortunate enough in Pennsylvania that there are two sisters that have a company called Answers, and they source pastured chickens and beef and grass fed, and they ferment everything and cheese from wow. A2 cows and we and goats and anchovies. And I have two places, actually one of the places in the Hazleton area make packages all this fermented food and puts it all together, and then another place they deliver it. So it's all fermented. They've had a lot of issues, but like me, it's, you know, they just keep, you know, standing by the way there's no chemicals in there and it's all natural. And my animals eat nothing but the best. They don't get any grains, and they eat a lot of fermented meat and fermented foods. They drink their raw milk, kefir, and I make sure that they, you know, another thing that we didn't discuss is, you know, the sauerkraut, you know, with the glyphosate all around us and in our water, we need to drink purified water. And if you give them like humic and fulvic acid, that really helps get rid of more toxins in their body. And when you're eating the fermented foods with turmeric in it, it keeps the fleas and the ticks away. So many people resort to flea and tick insecticides, and that kills the dogs. I'll see my animals with, you know, with ticks on them. My 13-year-old back in November went lame from a tick bite. I mildly panicked, but I thought, okay, I wasn't going to take her, stress her out to the emergency room. I fasted her, gave her fish broth and chicken bone broth with turkey, and just pipetted liquids in her and healthy ferments and beet kvass. And she was back to walking in 3 days. Same thing with my 23-year-old. If she has little hiccups, I will pipette some beet kvass, give her the raw milk, and they love it. And it's the probiotics, because it's the bacteria in the gut. It's all about the gut microbiome. And when they don't have a healthy gut microbiome, they're not going to live long. My 23-year-old Choppa is my little experiment. Every day is a gift with her. And she loves her fermented foods. She chows down quite a bit for a little cat.
That is incredible. Well, I read a long time ago, and I'm having a doctor behind the barf diet, which a lot of people may have heard of, about raw feeding for dogs and cats. But anyway, dogs in particular look for some amount of kind of gross fermented vegetable matter of some kind, because they would have in the wild been eating it out of the stomach of a giant animal that had been eating vegetables all day. And they would get a lot of the vitamins that were missing from other foods from that fermented food. So if you can just put in a little bit for your pet, sometimes you'd be surprised with how much they like them. But same thing with dogs. It's like, they might hate it at first. Sometimes you have to sneak it in there a little bit, right?
Yeah, just like kids, put it in the mashed potatoes.
Right, right.
Yeah. Sometimes my Maisie, she's like, what do you feed me, Hannah? If like the video, she'll just chow it down. You know, she loves it. And then they sleep it. The probiotics have that mood regulating effect that calms them down.
I love it. I love it. Well, we're just about out of time here, Tammy, but please, before we go, tell folks where they can find you, your work, your wonderful ferments, and what's coming next.
Well, I would love to have a partner that shares my vision and my passion. I would love to have my own place that I could eventually, you know, sell and ship or deliver within a radius. For now, I have my it needs to be updated, my website, fermenteddelightsandmore.com. But if anybody's in the Pennsylvania area in northeastern Pennsylvania, I'm at farmers markets. You can check my website. I'm on Facebook for now, and I post where I'm at. My first market of the season will be on April 23rd. It's called a maker's market. So it'll be, you know, the summer debut of the farmers markets. I'm very active at Forks Farm Market. That's one of my biggest markets. And then our Mountaintop area and the Bloomsburg area. And then my retail places. And I'm expanding out to Catawissa now. So people who are in the Pennsylvania area know where I'm at. And I picked up another one in a chiropractor's office called Healthy Habits next week, that's in the Pottsville area. So I'm a one-woman show. I do it all. I'll be 58 next month. So it's the power of fermented foods that saved my life. And if anybody, I do health coach. I do give, the fermented foods is my first business. I do have health evolution for life. But basically, I tell people it's pretty much, you know, it's a lifestyle change, and you have to be patient with yourself. And introducing the ferments is really the way to go, because food is medicine, and the fermentation process really adds a lot to your health.
I agree. Well, Tammy, we couldn't be more proud of you and everything that you've done since we first met, creating this wonderful business. And I'm really sincere when I say this is, you make some of the best ferments of all different kinds that we've ever tried. I didn't even talk about the fermented garlic in the honey, but that is changing my life. I'm doing one of those a day, and it is invigorating. I love it. So probably people need to work up to it a little bit, but man, what a wonderful business you've built. And I love all your creations. So thanks so much for doing what you do.
Thank you.
Hey, it's Abel one last time, and I just want to say thank you for listening to this episode of Fat Burning Man. Before you go, please smash that like button, hit subscribe, or even leave us a quick review. It helps so much more than you even realize. And if you can think of someone else who you care about, friend, family member, anyone else who might appreciate this free show, then please take a quick second just to share it with them. Word of mouth is really the way that we've grown this show over the years. We have more than, at this point, 4 awards in independent media, 50 million downloads. We couldn't do any of this without you, so we really appreciate it. If you'd like to get in touch with me, then please follow me under Abel James or Fat Burning Man on your social media platform of choice, and I'll do my best to get right back to you. Now, if you want to keep this show coming to you, you can do something really quickly here. My wife Allison and I, along with a very small team, depend on listeners like you to make this show happen week after week. To join our next challenge coaching group or get in touch with me one-on-one, visit fatburningman.com. We also make group coaching free with your subscribe and save orders from our family company, Wild Superfoods, which you can find at wildsuperfoods.com. And if you'd like, you can throw a few bucks into the tip jar as a one-time donation or become a contributing member of our group on Patreon. Just look up Abel James on Patreon and you can join in the fun for as little as a few bucks and get my international best-selling book and audiobook as a special thanks. You can also find that page at fatburningman.com/tipjar. Now, a quick disclaimer for all those legal eagles out there. The Fat Burning Man Show provides general information and discussions about health and related subjects. The information provided in this show or in any related materials are not intended and should not be construed as medical advice, nor is the information a substitute for professional medical expertise, diagnosis, or treatment. The opinions and views expressed on this show have no relation to those of any academic, hospital, health practice, or other institution, including corporate overlords. We don't have any of those. If you or any other person has a medical concern, I wholeheartedly encourage you to consult with your healthcare provider. Whew! Okay. Don't forget to join our newsletter over at fatburningman.com. When you sign up for our email, I'll even send you a wild quick start guide along with a few of our ridiculously tasty recipes, even Allison's famous chocolate cookies, as a special thanks for signing up. This is Abel James signing off. Thank you so much for listening, and have a great week.